happy.
My people lived in the mountains since the beginning of time. But soldiers killed my family. I'm all alone, and I don't know where I am.
We say we want a different world for our children. This torch, I believe, will carry that message from community to community, from capital to capital, from country to country, from people to people. Our children need peace.
This is Jim Grant, the head of UNICEF. This is the launch, September 16, 1986. 20,000 people have gathered. A strong message is read out by Reagan. The Secretary General of the United Nations receives the flame and passes it to other leaders, and two Special Olympians launch the flame on its journey around the world. Tens of thousands of Czechs join in. 100,000 Soviets and a strong message read out by Gorbachev. In a moment, a 15-year-old boy will hand a torch of peace to a great man of peace, as we intersected with the tour of the Pope. And as the Pope receives the flame, 60,000 children light candles, and the whole stadium is electrified. Linford Christie, the beloved Olympian, running with 5,000 youth into Birmingham Square, a poignant moment for a great Olympic athlete. We're invited by the President of Iceland to light a cauldron outside of where Gorbachev and Reagan were holding a summit meeting. An Arab and Jewish child bringing the flame together into the Knesset. The President of Kenya launching the flame through the Kenyan countryside. President of the Ivory Coast on his 81st birthday as he received the flame. 70,000 people have gathered to honor the flame's arrival in Abidjan. The president of Nigeria literally running with the flame. Uganda, the president receives it and then it goes to different parts of the country that were still suffering under the former rule of Idi Amin to serve as a healing. Bahrain Special Olympians carrying the flame. The Maasai warriors came running out of the savannah to add their extraordinary presence and knowing to the fire. The president of India, 10 cities, the Taj Mahal in the background. The king of Nepal receives it in the palace in Kathmandu, and from there it went to Lumbini, the birthplace of the Buddha, to light an eternal flame. This man carries the flame up Mount Everest as part of an Everest expedition. Here he's received by the governor of Tibet. It was also passed with an underwater torch by Cousteau in the South Pacific. The president of China receives the flame, and then 2 million people run onto the Great Wall of China, honoring the flame's arrival. In Bangkok, we were received by Buddhist monks in prayer and meditation who said, "A peaceful world begins with a peaceful mind."
What we want, now and forever.
She read that out to the Secretary General of the United Nations, who was literally moved to tears. 60,000 people gathered in Australia. Our Indian runner takes a boat across a river in Bangladesh and hands the flame to our African runner, who's decided she's going to take a shortcut. A beautiful poem read out by the president of Bangladesh. Belisa, a young girl carrying the flame, all of the Central American countries strongly committed. In Rio, they said, let us celebrate our possibility to live peacefully. And they had a wonderful concert honoring the flame's arrival. Burkina Faso, the third poorest country in our world, thousands of villages came running from the villages and said, yes, we too care. We want a better world. In Ottawa, they called a special session of Parliament and honored the flame's arrival. In Colombia, they had a fire engine escort. They didn't trust us at all. Costa Rica, a country with no standing army, for them a strong affirmation of their commitment to peace. An eternal flame was lit at the University of Peace that is still burning. El Salvador, some of the Special Olympians running with the flame. The flame was then brought to different parts of the country to serve as a healing balm. Maggie Thatcher received the flame, and then a double-decker peace bus moved through the city of London, and then we met with the Archbishop of Canterbury and children representing the different ethnic groups. Ethiopia, a spirit of celebration rarely seen in the West, and then the head of state receives the flame. I might add it was the only country that ever had rain on the entire journey. An artist in Paris honors the flame's arrival. Our Soviet undertakes a Parisian subway. In Berlin, as in all of the Eastern European countries, we sensed a stirring in the air as the people of that country honored the flame. Guatemala City, a lot of money raised for the children of that country. Budapest. In a moment, Kathleen Morvai, our Hungarian runner, faces the people of her country. And then tens of thousands of Hungarians run through Budapest, acknowledging the flame and its power in their country. The flame carried in a draft-proof miner's lamp is passed from Catholic Ireland to Protestant Northern Ireland, a remarkable moment of cooperation in the history of those two countries. And then the flame is carried through Northern Ireland by two-legged and four-legged runners alike. There were 45 countries on the main route, 17 tied in, that is, came and got the flame and brought it back to their country. The president of Italy, not to be outdone by the other heads of state in Europe, created a very special event and lit a cauldron, Italian style. There were six cities in Japan, including Hiroshima and Nagasaki. For them, it was a strong affirmation of the values they hold so dear. In Laos, we were received by the head of state, and from there, the Americans went to Vietnam to do a special healing between the people of those two countries. A full moon nighttime ceremony in Malaysia lights up the sky, and 5,000 children gathered and passed the flame from one to another. In the Netherlands, Prince Klaus receives the flame and creates a very powerful ceremony. New Zealand, the Prime Minister honoring the flame's arrival with indigenous people of his country. In Nicaragua, Ortega and the head of the Contras declared a ceasefire and had their children carry the flame together through downtown Managua. 600,000 Filipinos gathered to hear Cory Aquino offer an inspiring and stirring speech about her vision of world cooperation. In Warsaw, a country still devastated by the effects of World War II, poignant moment. Singapore, another celebration of our possibilities, beautiful concert, and Gail and I running in Barcelona. 65 different cities in the Soviet Union ultimately participated with the flame, and Zimbabwe, some of the children, in the spirit of celebration. Day 84, back in the United States, a well-worn torch. We're in Washington. The runners in blue from the United Nations come and join the runners in red who've been around the world. In a moment, we'll merge the flame with Kennedy's eternal flame, transforming it from death to hope. We did the same with Gandhi's memorial, the unknown soldier in Moscow, and many of the other eternal flames burning on the planet. And we enter Philadelphia, and there we experience some of the children who, like children everywhere, experience the flames' magic. And we cross the George Washington Bridge into New York, and we're told that the United Nations has called a special session of the General Assembly, that delegates from around the world have come to honor the flames' arrival. December 11th, a snowy evening. Our final torchbearer, a young boy, carries the flame into the General Assembly Hall. And we were told that a special sense of joy and hope descended that hadn't been there before. People from all over have gathered to honor the flame as it re-enters the United Nations. A poignant moment for Gail and myself, the completion of a 10-year dream. And in a moment, this young boy will bring the flame out onto the grounds of the United Nations and light a cauldron that represents the hope and the aspiration and the will of the millions of people on our planet who said, yes, we can create the world we want. We will create the world we want. It will be.